Hey.
And together with us, and let's rejoice in our God who gives us a way to heaven and a way to glory. We rejoice that we're marching to Zion this morning. We're giving him praise and we're glorifying him. He tells us all to come into his presence, to recognize his glory and his grace. So we lift our voices, we praise our Almighty God for the salvation that we will one day see face to face.
Come with us, the Lord.
That we are looking forward to seeing. God bless you. You may be seated.
Amen. We are a pilgrim priesthood, Peter says in his epistle. We are pilgrims in this world that we're just passing through, and each day we're taking one step closer to God's throne and heaven. And along the way, we are a priesthood, a holy priesthood, worshiping him and serving him here on this earth. And I want to invite you this morning as we worship a great and glorious God, that we intercede and pray, not only for our nation, as there's so many so many things that are in crisis right now, and we desperately need a move of God. It's God's church that needs to be pointing our nation upwards to Him. The answer and solution is our great and glorious God, not this government. We need to pray for our leaders to come and have a conscience, and if they don't have one, then for God to give us those that will have a conscience and fear Him this morning. We need to pray for brothers and sisters in Afghanistan who suddenly find themselves at the in danger's way, and we need to pray for God to give a hedge of protection about our brothers and sisters who are there. They're part of His glorious people called the church, and we are a part of them, and they're a part of us, and so we want to pray and intercede for them. And then within our own church family, so many in our church family just need a touch of God's healing grace this morning. And so I want you to pray with me this morning for our brother M.G. Bowes and our sister Gay Monday, for Carol Bova and Crystal Smith and Kathy Stewart, many others that you know. We pray for them every Wednesday night, but we want to intercede and pray for them this morning as well. So I want to invite you to come gather on the altar this morning as we go before the Lord in prayer, bringing our burdens and casting our cares on the Lord, realizing, Lord, that we've taken one step closer today to His throne, but we want to worship Him today as though we are there in His midst, because He is here in our midst. He is present in our lives, and we as the body of Christ have gathered now to worship Him, and we want to acknowledge His presence as we go before the Lord in prayer. So pray with me this morning. Father in heaven, we thank You that our pathway is sure. It's certain. While the pathway leads upward, and sometimes that's strenuous, Lord, and sometimes we need Your strength to make it, Lord, we are grateful that You supply everything we need along the way. Every grace, Lord, every mercy. God, we're grateful and thankful that what You began in us, You're faithful to complete. God, we know that what You have prepared for us, what Jesus has prepared for us, our eyes can't even imagine what it's going to be like. It's going to be glorious, Lord, and it's worth living for right now. And so, God, may we live boldly for that city. As citizens of that kingdom, may we not be ashamed of the gospel that's changed our lives and the gospel that can bring hope to our world, to our nation, to our community. Lord, it's Jesus that's the answer. God, we pray for grace for brothers and sisters who just need a healing touch this morning. We lift them before Your throne. Others who, Lord, we're burdened about them. And God, we know that Lord, You are working a plan according to Your purposes. God, You're working things in each of our lives and in their lives for Your glory. But God, may You just help them today to taste and experience a little of Your goodness and grace, whether it's healing, comfort, strength. Lord, be near and present like a good shepherd to them. And be near us today, Father, as we worship You here in this sanctuary, listening on the radio, watching on Facebook. God, we gather as Your people, a community of faith, with eyes of faith looking up to You, praying that You would speak to our hearts today, encourage us in our walk of faith, and Lord, may our worship along the way, Lord, may it be pleasing and glorious to You. We ask all these things today in the precious name of our King who sits enthroned in Zion with You, Jesus, for His glory. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Amen. Again, it's good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning as we gather to worship a great and glorious God. And if you're visiting with us today, you're our special guest, and we just have one request of you. If you don't mind, remain seated for just a moment to allow our church family to welcome you to the house of the Lord. We're going to do that by having all of our church family here at South River stand at this time, our brothers and sisters in Christ. And so, South River family, you stand at this time. If you see someone visiting with us seated, go make them feel welcome in God's house and tell your brother and sister you're glad to see them as well.
Well, let's gather back together. Guess you can go ahead and stand with us, and we're going to praise the Lord and thank Him that we have heaven to look forward to. We've already been singing about that, but when we get there, we recognize that Jesus is the name. His name is the name above all others, and His name is the only reason why we will be there. Let's praise Him this morning.
Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I see, the only name that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need, to feel my Father smiling on me, the only name that matters to me. And yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, the power forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I see, the only name that matters to me.
Affirm this truth.
And yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. When I wake up in the land of glory, with the saints I will tell my story.
Eternal life, and His name is the only reason why we will be there in glory. Let's continue to worship and to praise His glorious name.
Jesus, 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 just that name.
Jesus is above every other name. The only hope we have is in His name. And that's the name that we proclaim to others. What do we hear in America today? People want to talk about God, say God's name, and talk about Him. They're okay with that. But they don't want to name the name of Jesus. And as His people, as those who have been born again to a living hope, we need to proclaim His name to those around us and thank Him that His name is the name that saves us. As we enter into worship, as we've been worshiping already, in the midst of our worship, we look to His Word because it's His Word that gives us the truth of who He is. It reveals to us how awesome and how mighty our God is, and that we do have a hope in Jesus for eternity. We have that down payment right now by the Spirit of God that's in us. But we also have the hope of a city we will all go to. In the Old Testament, they had faith. Abraham had faith in trusting that God was leading him to that eternal city. And so as we open God's Word, what happens? God speaks. And then as He speaks, we need to do one other thing, and that's open our hearts to Him. Open our lives to Him and say, God, speak to me by Your Spirit through Your Word. Let's do that right now as we affirm His Word together. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return. But now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for He has prepared a city for them. He has prepared a city for us, and it's only by His grace. We only have forgiveness through the blood of the Lamb and through our Savior. And so as we continue to worship, we recognize He is the only hope that we have, and He has called us to be citizens of a heavenly kingdom, and we are going to that city because He has forgiven us.
I'm forgiven because You were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your Spirit is within me because You died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that You, my King, would die for me? Amazing love.
My joy to honor You in all I do.
Jesus, you are my King. You are my King. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Joy to honor you. Oh, amazing love.
Amazing love.
How can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love. I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you.
Lord, we honor you. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. Thank you that you have extended your amazing love to us. And if we believe what we have just sung, Lord, we know it's true. We know in our hearts, we know in our lives, because you have changed us, you have made us new, that we have been forgiven and we have been washed with the blood of our blessed Savior who died on the cross so that all could know eternal life. You're not willing that any should perish, but all would come to repentance. And God, I pray for anyone here today who may not know you personally, that may not know that forgiveness, that new life that you've extended to them, Lord, by the end of this service today, may they receive that life. May they bow their knee and surrender their lives to you. God, we pray that with all of our hearts today. Lord, as we continue to worship and to praise you with our giving, may you be glorified and may we show where our faith really is. It's not in the dollar, God. It's in your provision for us. And we thank you, Lord, that you call us to give and you bless us when we give for your glory. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
lost sinner as we've never prayed before. For the time is drawing nearer. It is even at the door. But we're going to a city to see Jesus over there, where the sun is always shining, no more burdens to bear. Where the sun is always shining, no more burdens to
Amen. Praise the Lord, Miss Darlene. Thank you for reminding us today that we are on a pilgrim's pathway and we are heading to a glorious city. The children are heading off to Children's Church to learn from Pastor Stephen and God's Word and that city that God is preparing for them and for us and for all who walk by faith. And we're taking this book right here, this Bible, and we're holding it in our hands this morning because I believe every word that it says. I believe what it says about a place called heaven. I believe what it says about a place called hell. They're both real. Literally, I believe literally what the Word of God says to you this morning. I mean, it's one thing to sing about it. It's one thing to believe it and live like you believe it. And millions of saints throughout the ages have entered into death longing to go to that city of God, taking that final step through that doorway of death into the glorious presence of God. In fact, all the way back in the book of Genesis, it's amazing to discover that it was the father of faith, Father Abraham, who had eyes that saw or was looking for the city whose builder was God. In fact, over in the book of Genesis, in chapters 11 and 12, what you discover is men are building a city there in chapter 11, the Tower of Babel, and would be emblematic and symbolic of this Babylonian world system that people live for in this world, and reigns and rules over so many's hearts. But then you have this one man that God chooses to make his name famous so that he can make God's name famous. And Abraham had to leave his homeland. The call of God came to him, and he had to walk by faith and follow God to the place that God would show him. The author of Hebrews says it this way: by faith, Abraham, when he was called, obeyed, by going out to a place which he was to receive for an inheritance. And he went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he lived as an alien in the land of promise. Now, that's not an alien like, you know, one of them funny-headed big eyes, you know. He's a stranger in the place, in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, fellow heirs of the same promise. Why? For he was looking for the city which has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. What did Abraham see? What was he longing for? What was he looking for? What was he living for? The city whose builder is God. The city with foundations that will never crumble or fall or fail. Unlike every city on the face of the earth, they all come toppling down, but Abraham was looking for this city. And he's an example for you and for me. He's an example for everyone who will live by faith. Listen, we go to a place we've not known. We're called to a place that God is going to show us. We walk by faith today. You walk by faith, trusting in God's word. Abraham just had a single simple promise. Look at all the word we have from God. All of this that we hold in our hands, a message to you and to me, that there is a place that it is worth living for today. It is worth longing for today. And you and I are to demonstrate the same eyes of faith, live by the same principle of faith, and demonstrate today that we are citizens not of this world. We're aliens. We're strangers. We're just passing through. We belong to a city that is to come, the New Jerusalem. Now, there was an old Jerusalem. In fact, it's the mother city of Israel. It's a place where God said, I'm going to put my name there, my presence there. And he did. In the tabernacle, in the temple, there with priests who served there, the presence of God, the Shekinah glory of God there, though veiled, you couldn't see all of it, right? But it was there. But what we know about that city is God wanted it to be a lighthouse to the world around us, and that others would say, we've got to go to that city. And that all pointed to the New Jerusalem that would come. In fact, the old Jerusalem didn't remain faithful. It wasn't always true to what God had called her to be, a witness and a lighthouse to the world around them, to nations around them, of people separated, living their lives for this great and glorious God. And as that old Jerusalem declined, there were some prophets that spoke, Ezekiel, Isaiah, seeing and writing about the city that they saw, the temple that they saw reconstructed, a latter-day Jerusalem, the new Jerusalem, they spoke of it in glowing terms, and the presence, the Shekinah presence of God there. It was God's city, Zion, the new Jerusalem. And it's in Revelation chapter 21 that we read about it. Now, Abraham was living for this, and so are you, and so am I. Well, we're supposed to be. But we have to have faith like Father Abraham, looking for this city. When we're looking for this city, it affects my priorities in life. All of my plans, everything is surrendered to the plans of the king of this city and what he wants. We're seeking first the kingdom of God and the righteousness that goes along with it. Everything is affected in my life, in your life, and it should be, as a testimony that we have the same faith as Father Abraham. Now, as we open the Word of God this morning and we hear God speak, we're going to hear an incredible description of this city. And there's not a lot of details about why it is the way it is, but it gives you and I a picture of this is a city worth living for. Because there's no city like this on the face of the earth. There never has been, there never will be. And only God could build a city like this. In fact, Jesus has promised us this city. He's gone away to prepare this for us. And beloved, just as he went away, he's coming again. And you should be living for that. I don't know when that's going to be. It could be today. It could be tomorrow. No one knows. But you're supposed to live with an expectancy that it could be any moment. And so let's pray today. And let's hear God speak to us today and ask God to help us to hear what he has to say. That not only we have anointed preaching, but we have anointed hearing and anointed eyes to see what God is showing us and why it's worth living for this city today. Not holding on too tightly to the world around you. Beloved, this one's going to crumble. It's going to burn up. Don't hold on to it. I mean, you see it falling apart everywhere right now. But this is the one we're living for. We got our eyes on another city that's come. Let's read about it this morning. Revelation chapter 21. I'm in verse 9 this morning. If you'll stand with me and honor the word of the Lord. This is what God has said. Jesus has said he's preparing for you and for me. And then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls filled with the seven last plagues came to me. And he talked with me, saying, come, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife. And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and he showed me the great city. But that, why would it be a city and not a people? Because people constitute, make up that city. And the city is the dwelling place of those people, the bride, the Lamb's wife. This is the holy Jerusalem descending out of heaven from God. Having the glory of God, her light was like the most precious stone, like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. Father in heaven, we're going to read a description of what Jesus is preparing for us. And yet we are reminded of what Paul says, that eye has not seen, nor has entered into the mind of man, God, all that you have prepared for us. But God, as we read this and we see the description of it, God, may you inspire us to walk more closely with you, more intimately with you, longing for this city, realizing, Lord, that much of what we hold on to in this world isn't worth living for. God, they're just tawdry trinkets, Lord, that really don't have any eternal weight. But God, may we live for that which is to come. And God, may we store up our treasure here in this city. And God, may our lives be changed. And God, we pray that you'd help us to be a bold witness to those around us who have not yet discovered this city and why it's worth living for. Lord, we love you. We praise you. In the Spirit of God, we ask that you now speak to us. It's in the precious, powerful name of Jesus, our Savior. We ask it today. Amen. And amen, you may be seated. Over in Revelation chapter 3, Jesus speaks to the church in Philadelphia. And his word to the church of brotherly love is this: in the midst of your conflict, in the midst of all the adversity, in the midst of all your hardships, there is a promise that I have for you who will overcome. One day you will be citizens of the new Jerusalem. By faith, those in that city of brotherly love heard that word and they lived that word. And that's a word for you and for me today. In the midst of trial, in the midst of conflict, in the midst of adversity and difficulty, all that this world can throw at us, that there is a city worth living for, the new Jerusalem. And here in chapter 21, the promise is fulfilled. The victorious people of God, those who have overcome, as verse 7 said last week, those who have overcome are there in the presence of God, and they are in the new Jerusalem. Now, the description of it is crystal clear. He speaks in relatively simple terms that you and I can identify with materials that we see and we know about on this earth to describe this city. But the explanation of it is more complicated because he doesn't explain why things are this way. But what he gives you a picture of is a glorious city, a great city. It's God's city, and the greatness of it is tied to the one who is there, God himself. His glorious presence among his people. John is carried away by this angel to a high mountain, and he's to reveal to him the city of God, the Lamb's wife, the bride, who is this great city. All of the judgment has taken place. The eternity has begun. And now the angel that had one of those bowls of wrath takes him away, whisks him away, and shows this to John. All of the saved people are going to be present in this city. Any and everyone who had a faith in the Lord and walked by faith that God would keep his word and repented of their sins and placed their faith and trust in the Messiah, either the one that he would send as an Old Testament saint, believing in the seed that would come and crush the serpent's head, or those who believe in Jesus, who is the Messiah, looking back and realizing it was at the cross of Calvary where victory was won for you and for me. The angel shows him the Lamb's wife, the bride, all those who've been saved by grace. And just as Peter said, that which our inheritance, which is imperishable and undefiled, which is will not fade away and is reserved or protected by God in heaven, all of that, here we see, God kept his word. Praise the Lord. Everything that Jesus said, he's going away to prepare a place for you. John chapter 14. And the disciples wondered about the way to get there. And Jesus said, well, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father but by me. You want to come to the place I'm preparing for you? You come by the way I say. And it's through Jesus and him alone. This is the city where Jesus will be crowned king over his people, where God will dwell with his people. And never again will we have to deal with the effects of sin in a world. No. It'll be a glorious and a great city. A glorious one is there. It is the glory of God that shines brightly in that city, like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. You can just imagine the brightest, shiniest diamond and how all the light shines upon that diamond, and every facet of it just reflects that light out. There is something glorious about this city, and it is God's glorious presence, his greatness that is there, that reflects all throughout that city, and it sparkles and shines in such brilliance that you and I will not even, we cannot even imagine what it will look like. No longer will we be hindered from experiencing the glorious presence of God. We will see Him as He is, and no one will be there to veil Him. Nothing will be there to veil His presence from His people, because we will dwell with Him. Right now, God's glorious presence dwells within us by the Spirit of Almighty God. But we don't see it, but we know His presence. We sense His presence. He guides us into all truth. But there we will dwell with Him, and we will see Him as He is. And beloved, we will be with Him forever. It's a grand city. There's no city like this city, and John describes it. She, verse 12, he says, she had a great and high wall with 12 gates and 12 angels at the gates, and names written on them, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. Three gates on the east, three on the north, three gates on the south, and three gates on the west. And the wall of that city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And he who talked with me had a gold reed to measure the city, its gates and its walls. And the city is laid out as a square. The length is as great as its breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. Its length and breadth and height are equal. Then he measured its wall, 144 cubits, according to the measure of a man, that is, of an angel. And the construction of the wall was of jasper, and the city was pure gold, like clear glass. The description of this city is, it blows your mind when you take the magnitude of it and you consider just how great this city is and the grandeur of it. The exterior of it, surrounded by a wall that is high and great. 12 gates are in those walls, representing the 12 tribes of Israel. In other words, God keeps His covenant with His people, just as He promised them in the Old Testament. And He keeps His promise with the apostles, the church, the New Testament saints, as all the foundations of that city have the names of the 12 apostles, all the New Testament believers, all the Old Testament believers. God is faithful to His people, and we make it there. He who began the good work is faithful to complete it. Beloved, let me say this morning, no matter what the world throws at you, the God that you are trusting in, the faith that you have in Jesus Christ, is worth holding on to and retaining and living for and telling others about. Because one day we will be there in His presence, and you will praise His name when you get there. Amen. The expanse, just think about it. There's no city as big as this. The city is so large, only God could construct it. The angel takes this golden reed and he begins to measure everything. And what he says is it's laid out like a square. In fact, it's like a cube. I don't know what that means, whether it means just something very stable that God has built, perfect as any cube would be. But that's the picture of what God has for us. The length, the breadth, the height, they're all equal, 1,200 furlongs. How many miles is that, by the way? 1,400 miles. I mean, you just imagine a city from Syracuse, New York, all the way down to Miami, across over to Midland and Odessa, Texas, up to Cheyenne, Wyoming, and back. That's how large this city is. We can't even fathom the size of that. But, beloved, that is a city big enough, listen, for all of the saints to dwell in with the glorious presence of God. The city walls are 216 feet, whether that's the depth or the height. The point is this, they're enormous. This isn't the Great Wall of China. That makes the Great Wall of China look like a bunch of Legos stacked on top of one another. It's large enough for all of us to dwell within. And the point there is this, there within that city, everything that you and I need, as we'll discover next week in chapter 22, everything that we need is there in the glorious presence of God. No restricted districts, no segregated housing, just one grand and glorious city with God's people dwelling there. And it shines like a jasper stone or a diamond. It's constructed of pure gold and clear glass. Imagine 1,400 square miles of a city made of diamond and of gold. I mean, you can't imagine what that's like. The foundations only add to its beauty. He speaks of all these stones in verses 19 and 20. And the stones that are the precious stones of jasper and sapphire and chalcedony and emerald and sardonyx and sardius and chrysolite and beryl and topaz, chrysoprase and jacinth and amethyst. all of these stones that are laid out, they're the precious stones that we like to put on our finger and around our neck. And yet, this is just the foundation stones that God uses. Pure streets of gold, 12 gates made of pearls, so big you can't imagine the size of that pearl. What is it? It's a description of a city trying to use words that we are familiar with. And yet, beloved, when you stop and you consider what is really being said here, you and I still can't imagine everything God has in store for us. That they're not adequate to describe everything that is present in that New Jerusalem. But it's enough to say, wow, I want to go there. I want to go to that city. And yet the most glorious thing of that city is not the greatness of the city or the grandeur of it, the scope of the breadth of the city, but it's the glorious presence of God there. In verses 22 through 26, it talks about the glory. In fact, you might want to circle it over and over again. He'll mention this word glory, glory, glory. I saw no temple in it. Why? For the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city had no need of the sun or of moon to shine in it. Why? Here it is. For the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light. And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light. And the kings of the earth bring their glory and honor into it. Its gates shall not be shut at all by day. There shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and the honor of the nations into it. God's glorious presence there illumines all of the city. It's the place where His name dwells, where His presence dwells. His throne will be established there, and He will reign and He will rule. And Jesus will be the light that illuminates all of that city. God's Shekinah glory. And that glory, men will bring their glory, and trust me, it pales in comparison to God's glory. But anything and great that they've done, they bring into that city, all to bring glory and honor to the Lamb. There's no temple there. Why? Where there's no need for a mercy seat anymore. Praise the Lord, we arrive. There's no need for sacrifices for sin because there is no more sin. There's no need for God's presence to dwell behind a veil because the veil's been torn in two because of the cross of Christ. And we now dwell in God's presence, never separated from His glorious presence ever again. That's the beauty of it. The light of God shining in that city. No sun, no moon. In fact, the sun right now, it pales in comparison to the glory of the Lamb of God. There's no darkness here. Why? Because there's no effects of sin any longer. There's no prince of power of darkness. He's been cast into the lake of fire. There's just an eternal day, an eternal time that we will dwell in God's presence. There'll never be a dusk or a dawn. The sun won't rise and the sun won't fall. We will just dwell in an eternal state with God, a glorious, glorious day with our King and our Lord and our Savior. And the glory of God is what fills all of it. Now, we saw a picture over in Revelation chapter 4 and 5 when the angels gave a picture and John saw the presence of God in heaven and the glorious one who sat there. And many of these stones were there like rainbows around his throne and the appearance of an emerald sea. In fact, it was said that when rumblings came forth from the throne room of God, as judgment was being poured out, that it was His glorious presence. No one could go into His presence. And yet here we will be in His presence. And we will enjoy Him forever and ever. Now here's why we want to go to that city. Here's the guarantee He gives us in verse 27. But there shall by no means enter anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You see, this glorious city that God has built, that God has prepared for His people, where His glorious presence will dwell, one day His guarantee is this: there will be nothing there to torment or cause turmoil in your life. One day we will dwell there in His presence. And we have no fear of any enemy, of any lie, of anyone to seduce us or lead us astray, because God will have already dealt with the devil. God will already dealt with all our enemies, sin and death. God will deal with all of that. Heaven is the perfect place, a perfect place of shalom, of peace. And no longer will we have to fear any attack. Nothing that could defile it will ever enter in. In other words, listen, here's the other thing. A lot of people today wonder about the problem of evil in this world. And how is it possible that a God who is love, a God who is good, a God who has all the power, how could he allow this to happen? Why can't he just deal with it? Why didn't he deal with it from the beginning? Well, the best we can understand in a theodicy, an understanding of this is this. This present world is the best option to get to this world we're reading about this morning. That God allows these things to happen. Though what's amazing is this. The beginning and the end, God knew it all. He saw it all. And he made a provision for it all, even before it all began. Because those who are written, whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that lamb was slain from the foundation of the world. And so those who make the Lamb their foundation will dwell in the perfect place called heaven. And everyone that is there will have chosen God to love him more than anything in this world. And those are the ones, listen, that aren't mere robots in his presence. No, they made a choice. Just like you and I have to make a choice. What are we going to live for? What this world has to offer? But if I can tell you, this world doesn't compare to what we're reading about, the New Jerusalem. I'm looking forward to this day. I can imagine a city without the presence of sin, without the presence of Satan. The one who's brought devastation to people's lives, the one that has brought trouble into people's lives. I'm looking forward to that day where there's no more trials, a heavenly city. God allows any and all who will acknowledge he is King of kings and Lord of lords, and will bend their knee, that they no longer will have to experience any trouble or turmoil in that day. You know the amazing thing about this city? It will never decay. It will never need to be have some repairs made. No, it's a perfect place. We'll never tire of enjoying the beauty and the splendor of it all, because we'll be there with God, and his glorious presence will shine through it all. A holy and a heavenly city. It staggers your imagination this morning, just as we try to consider it and fathom what God is saying, but we accept it by faith. There's a great deal of symbolism here. We can't understand everything that's here. Our mind can't figure it all out, but what it is a picture of an ideal city where you, listen, it not only doesn't only belong in the future, but it belongs right now in your heart and my heart. As we live by faith, people of God walking to that city as pilgrims on a pathway to him. We belong to it. Our citizenship is written down there. In eternity, the saints are going to enjoy this sweet intimacy with God and a new order where there's no sorrow. But in order for that to happen, you have to establish your citizenship there. I mean, are you amazed right now what people are willing to do down on the southern border to get into this country, to get citizenship here? I mean, some of them will load themselves into 18-wheelers, drive across the hot desert with no guarantee that someone will open the doors and let them out, right? They'll get into boats in shark-infested waters off of Florida, right? Just if hopefully that they can get across those waters and become citizens of this nation. All the things that people will do, packing themselves, some will even sell themselves into servitude just to get into this nation, to be citizens here. And I can tell you, America does not compare to heaven. No. It's defiled. It's decaying. It's going to be destroyed one day, beloved. And yet they're willing to do that for citizenship here. What should we be willing to do for citizenship? Citizenship as part of his kingdom that lasts forever. I mean, this kingdom is the eternal one. And the guarantee is this, beloved, we go through this world, we experience the trials, we navigate them by faith, we rest in his grace, we're comforted by his grace and mercies, but one day we get there. But in order for that to happen, listen, you have to establish your citizenship there. How do you do that? How do you establish your citizenship? Well, first off, you realize you don't deserve it. And you can't earn it. You can't be good enough to get there. In fact, you have to look with eyes of faith, just as Abraham did, and just like every other saint. You have to look to that seed that God promised the woman he would send that would crush the serpent's head. You have to look to that seed, the one that they knew would come from the tribe of Judah, that would have a scepter that would reign forever and ever. You have to look to that one, the scarlet thread all throughout the Old Testament, the one that would be born in Bethlehem, the one that would be betrayed by some shekels of silver. You have to look to the one, listen, who would come first as a suffering servant and by whose stripes you could be healed, but would come again as a conquering king. You see, the one that fulfilled all those Old Testament prophecies is Jesus. Your faith has to be in Jesus. You have to recognize, I can't save myself, but I believe Jesus died on that cross and paid the penalty that I deserve for my sin. And I want to repent of my sin. And I want to bend my knee and say, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner and I cannot save myself. But I want to put my trust in Jesus and the sacrifice he has offered for me. And anyone and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Your citizenship is then written in that Lamb's book of life. His blood covers you and covers me. And we then receive by faith his righteousness. And he pays the penalty for our unrighteousness. Anyone who is willing today to acknowledge, I'm not worthy, I realize Jesus died for me. I'm repenting of my sins. I'm turning from my sin and myself. And I want to put my faith and trust in Christ Jesus. You become a citizen of heaven. Your name is written down somewhere. My mama was born in World War II in Salisbury, England. She is a citizen of England, the United Kingdom. Of course, when she came over at the end of the war, she grew up in the United States of America, and she had to apply for citizenship later on, and she did. She's a dual citizen of England and of the United States of America, and a lot of things she had to do to go through tests to get her citizenship and become a citizen of the United States of America. Beloved, it's not that difficult to become a citizen of heaven. The hardest thing is for you to say, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. And I cannot save myself. That's the hardest thing. Because you see, that means you have to crush your pride this morning. It means you and I have to say, you know what? We can't do it in ourselves. Stop trying. Heaven is not about trying harder. It's about dying to self and realizing Christ has done everything that you and I couldn't do. And putting your faith and trust in him. Now, I don't know how soon this is coming, but it is coming soon. Beloved, you need to be ready. In fact, you need to make certain that your family knows and has that peace and that assurance, because we're not promised tomorrow. And one of the greatest challenges that we have as we minister to those who grieve the loss of a loved one is sometimes they wonder, well, did he have faith? Did she have faith? Are they in heaven? I would want my children to know, my grandchildren to know, my faith rests in Jesus and him alone. I'm trusting in him for my salvation. Don't you worry when I'm passing on, because I'm just stepping over to the other side, to all that Jesus has prepared for me. There's a great assurance for families that have that peace, knowing that their loved one has stepped over to the other side. In fact, you're inspiring them to live by faith as you do that. That this city is worth living for. It changes my priorities and all of my purposes in life. The plans that I have, I'm looking forward to what God has and the reward that he has for me. But is that the case for you today? Is your name written down in the Lamb's book of life? Has there been a moment in your life where you've said, God, I'm not worthy. Have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. I believe Jesus died on that cross for my sins. And I want to repent of my sin and put my trust in Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. If the Spirit of God is convicting you this morning and saying to you, listen, whether you're in this sanctuary, you're watching on Facebook, or you're listening on the radio, listen, if God's Spirit is convicting you this morning, that's you. You need to place your faith and trust in Christ. Then today is the day of salvation. And all you have to do is take a step of faith. Beloved, paradise is not on this earth. It's in heaven. And you were made for His throne. God's desire is that you come. He's wooing you right now. He's demonstrated His love towards you and towards me and to this whole world by sending His Son to die for us. Will you come and take His nail-pierced hand and say, by faith, I want to believe in Jesus as my Lord and Savior? Maybe you've done that, but you've not planted your life in a local body of believers that want, and God has led you here to South River Baptist Church, and you just want to lock arms with us and take this gospel and this hope of heaven that's in our hearts to a world around us who desperately needs to know it, then maybe today's the day you need to plant your life here and become members of South River Baptist Church. Maybe you just want to get on the altar. You know people that aren't going upward to Zion. They're going downward to the other fiery place called hell, which is a literal place. And today, you know what? You're burdened, and you just want to come and pray for them because you want them to turn while there's time. Beloved, when's the last time you shed a tear over a lost soul? When's the last time we cried out for God to have mercy on someone and were burdened for their salvation? I want to invite you today to have one name that you're lifting up before the Lord that needs to be saved. And ask that God would grant them the repentance that leads to life. They may be in the sanctuary this morning. They may not be here. But they still need Jesus. So let's intercede and pray for that this morning. But now's the opportunity for you to make a decision, to take a step of faith as God's Spirit has spoken to you. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, and the pianist is going to come and play. No one is standing, no one is singing, and no one should be looking around. We should all be looking within and asking this question: is my citizenship in heaven? Am I a part of God's people? And if you've never trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, never put your faith and trust in Him, then we want to invite you this morning to come and trust in Jesus and ask Him to be your Savior and Lord, or to plant your life here at South River Baptist Church and help us as we take this word to a world around us who desperately needs to know Jesus. The altar's open for any that want to come to pray, for God's Spirit to work on the heart of a loved one, a friend, someone at work, a co-worker who desperately needs Jesus. God's desire is that they not perish. God's desire is that they come to repentance. It's what God's will is. Just ask God, God, I want to see your will realized in so-and-so's life. God, I am burdened this morning. I know my citizenship is in heaven, but I'm not certain about theirs. But God, today, I just want to pray for them and plead for them and ask that your eyes, you would open their eyes, Lord God, and shine the light of the gospel into their hearts, that they might come and they might come to you today.